next topic, that is environmental issues. In today's class, I'll be discussing about air pollution, case study of the air pollution in Delhi. Okay, then we'll also be discussing about water pollution and case study of domestic sewage treatment in one of the place in California. So they have formed an organization also called as FOAM, F-O-A-M. So you should remember this facts. It's very easy to understand, not much difficult. Already you have studied about air pollution, water pollution, definition of pollution. Okay, so we'll go for the what is pollution? Any undesirable change in the physical, chemical and biological characteristics of air, water, soil or land. We call this as pollution. Okay? The agent which causes pollution, we call it as pollutant. What is pollution? Any undesirable change in the physical, chemical and biological characteristics of land, air, water and soil. We term it as pollution, usually caused by the human activities. Okay, undesirable change it is, not something which is of benefit, it is harmful. Okay, the agent which causes that change, we call it as the pollutant. These are certain terms that you should remember about. In case if they ask you what is air pollution, define air pollution. Any undesirable change in the physical, chemical and biological characteristics of air brought due to human activities is termed as air pollution. What is water pollution? Any undesirable change in the characteristics of biological, physical and chemical characteristics of water is termed as water pollution, and it is due to human activities that the pollution is happening. Okay. And pollutant is any solid, liquid or gas released into the environment in huge quantities. Sometimes there might be natural pollutants like lava from a volcanic eruption. It can be a natural pollutant. So soil erosion can be a natural pollution. Okay. So the hailstorm, sometimes the the hurricanes, they are also some of the natural pollutants which changes the profile of it. Okay. So the Environment Protection Act 1986 to protect and improve the quality of our environment, it has been enacted by Government of India, Environment Act. So air pollution and its control. Air pollution, what are all the air pollutants that can be? We had already discussed about physical characteristics. Okay. It can be an increase. Chemical characteristics is more important, like increase in carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide of the air because of industries and automobile exhaust. They are all chemical pollutants that causes the air pollution. Okay, what can be the physical pollutants? Particulates, small particles which are suspended in air. When we inhale them, we get lot of diseases from these particulate matter. Okay. So those are all the physical pollutants that can be found physically in the air. Sometimes pollen grains are present in them. Biological pollutants, you can also call them as. They cause asthma-like symptoms. Partenium is believed to cause asthma-like symptoms. Okay, the pollen grains of Partenium. So they are all some of the agents that you should remember are carried by the air. Pollen grains, biological agents, pollen grains, spores are there in the air. So they are also going to cause lot of abnormalities. Apart from the disease causing organisms like plague, it's a air polluted disease, airborne disease we call it as. Plague. Surat, they had a plague around 8 to 10 years back. Okay, plague was considered to be the black widow in the earlier days because it used to wipe out cities and villages together. So that is what was the effect of plague. Now there are many other airborne diseases, H1N1. So that's the reason they are all isolated in the isolation wards of old Madras Road, they have this government isolation wards where such dangerous airborne disease affected individuals are quarantined. They are separated from the population so that these airborne diseases cannot be spread. So there are many such diseases which are also carried by air. Okay. So now effect of air pollution, they cause injury to all living organisms. Breathing, respiratory issues are majorly because of that. Reduced growth and yield of crops. Now sulfur dioxide is released from an industry, maybe a metallurgical industry. So one of the output is sulfur dioxide. How does it come back to earth? As acid rain. Some amount of SO2, it mixes with water to form sulfuric acid. And the, along with rain, a little amount of sulfuric acid is also brought down to the soil. It changes the soil profile. From alkaline, it can become acidic. The plants which receive such acidic rain, they get damaged. See, Taj Mahal is being renovated, the marbles, because of this acid rains, they have changed the color of the marbles. Okay. So there are such as things. It might also cause premature death of plants. Air pollution. Chlorofluorocarbons, you have heard about. Where are they released from? CFCs. From refrigerators. And what do they break? Ozone layer. O3. You know the ozone symbol to be O3. They break down that. Once there is holes in the ozone layer, what does it lead to? Ultraviolet radiations directly falls onto us. It's like a protective layer for us. See, ozone layer provides us the UV protection. When that itself is destroyed, we are directly exposed to ultraviolet radiations which causes skin cancer. Plants also ultraviolet radiations, if they fall directly, they are going to lead to the destruction of leaves. Okay? So causes premature death of plants. Affects the respiratory system of human beings. Particulate size 2.5 micrometers. Or lesser than that, it is very, very harmful for us because it enters deep into our lungs, into the alveoli they enter. This 2.5 micrometers of particulate, suspended particles, we call it as particulate matter. Okay? So, and it leads to symptoms like irritation, inflammation, okay, and damage to the lungs and premature death. So, inflammation of bronchi, when they inflammate, breathing becomes a problem. Asthma symptoms, wheezing sounds, you might have noticed. Okay? Because of excess secretion of mucus, they would have blocked the air passage. Because of which they create that wheezing sounds. They find it difficult to breathe in air. Lot of respiratory disorders that many of our young children and you might be facing might be because of air pollution. Suddenly you find when you go to fresh air, you don't see such symptoms in it. Okay? So remember about this particulate size matter which can enter into our lungs, into our respiratory system. They are going to cause various inflammation of the lungs, irritation, inflammation of bronchi. Okay? Then they might also damage the lungs and lead to premature death. Now pollution caused by thermal power plants. Thermal power plant. So there are sources of particulate matter. Thermal power plants, melters they will be using. Okay. They would also have those plants in which particulate matter and gaseous air polluted. Particulate matter are suspended particles. Okay. And harmless gas is also released, nitrogen and oxygen, apart from toxic gases. So we can use electrostatic precipitator. I don't know if they have given the diagram also. Yes. See, electrostatic precipitator is this. See, scrubber is shown in the first part. Dirty air, that is the air with pollutants, they are taken inside and they are passed through this, what we call it as the scrubber. And above the scrubber there is a water on light layer passing on. So all this particles are trapped, particulate can be trapped by the scrubbers. Then there are certain elements, toxic elements, gaseous elements which can get dissolved in water or light spray. This is about a scrubber. So the particulate matter are all getting settled down here. Okay. So the clean air comes out. Tomorrow, instead of AC, we might have to utilize in our homes electrostatic precipitators. We require them. Future will be that we should be having them as a magnetic thing. Reason is air is getting polluted so much. Particulate matters are more in the air. So to get a pure air, we require this. Already we have some of these developed, especially where we are using scrubber to trap the particulate matter. And we are also passing the layer of water or lime spray so that the gaseous elements, toxic gaseous elements gets dissolved in them. And only we get an exposure to clean air. Or there might be an electrostatic precipitation. So that might also be the possibility. The electrostatic precipitators, they have electrodes with high voltage. And at that high voltage, a corona is created. And the particulate matters, they all become negatively charged and they are a part of this corona. Okay, the dust particles, they all get trapped from the electrode which is generating high voltage of power. Okay, high power of voltage, and this electrodes are like from the corona. In the corona, the particulate matters combine, they become negatively charged and combine with them, and that is how we can remove this particulate matter and the purified clean air is passed inside. This is what you have to remember about electrostatic precipitator. There are some of them. This may be in your industries they can utilize it. Industries are making out smoke without checking them. They can use this electrostatic precipitator and scrubber so that clean air is allowed to go out. See, industries are anti thing, but at the same time, whatever byproducts from the industries, they can also be controlled. To an extent, they are expensive, that's the reason many of the industries don't implement this electrostatic precipitators. But they are mandatory to keep the air pure. Okay. So remember about them. Then methods to reduce vehicular pollution. Already we are using unleaded petrol. Earlier days they were using leaded petrol. Lead was required, tetraethyl lead, TEL they call it as. It was an anti-knocking agent. Without this tetraethyl lead, the engines used to make noise, knocking sound. So whenever they added in petrol, tetraethyl lead, they were anti-knocking agents and there was no such sounds created. But today, the engines have all modified. They have developed such wonderful engines that they don't create this knocking sounds. Today, without leaded petrol, we can have them. So we are getting commercially unleaded petrol. Earlier, petrol had lead and lead component was released into atmosphere. Lead is highly poisonous. The more colorful the paint is, it has more amount of lead. Especially the toys that the children keep in their mouth, we should be very careful. Because if lead consumption it takes in inside, it is going to affect the central nervous system. See, Roman Empire probably might have disintegrated because they started supplying water in lead pipes. So the day they started supplying water in lead pipes, it also led to their collapse of central nervous system. That is what some of the hypothesis is there for the Roman Empire or Roman civilization to get destroyed. So lead is highly toxic. You should understand about that. Okay. Silver is a water purifier. That is a different aspect. Anyway, use of lead-free petrol or diesel can reduce vehicular pollution. Then there are catalytic converters. Catalytic converters, they are acting as catalysts in absorbing the particulates. Especially metals like platinum, palladium, they are all expensive. Okay. So those if they are using it, having expensive metals, namely platinum, palladium and rhodium as a catalyst, these metals reduce emission of poisonous gases. They are going to absorb them. If vehicle exhaust has these metals as a part of it, this catalytic converter is there, then it would be very helpful. But whenever a vehicle has a catalytic converter, they should not be having leaded petrol because lead is going to hinder or it prevents the catalytic converter from functioning. It inhibits the activity of catalytic converter, lead. That is the reason unleaded petrol should be used, unleaded diesel should be used whenever we are using catalytic converter. So the unburned hydrocarbons are also converted by this catalytic converter into their carbon monoxide and other things will be there. They are converted into harmless carbon dioxide gas and water vapors. See, the carbon monoxide and nitric oxide are also changed to carbon dioxide and nitrogen gas respectively. These points you have to write about whenever you are discussing about catalytic converter. What are the metals they are formed of, and they shouldn't be exposed to lead. That also you have to write. So unleaded petrol or unleaded diesel should be used in such vehicles which are having catalytic converter. They are going to convert toxic gases into non-poisonous gas. Especially unburned hydrocarbons, they are going to convert into carbon dioxide and water. The carbon monoxide and nitric oxide, they are going to convert into carbon dioxide and nitrogen, which are liberated. They are harmless gases. Okay. So motor vehicles which are equipped with catalytic converter, okay, you can notice here the motor vehicles that are all utilized with catalytic converter, they have this. So that diagram might not be required. Anyway, so a case study has been done in Delhi. Delhi is a place where there is smog. What is smog? Smoke plus fog. Smoke with particulate particles and fog. See, they declare holidays because of smog. China, Beijing city, it had a huge smog wherein for nearly 5 to 6 days they did not have any, the people did not venture out of their homes because of this pollution. Okay. Earlier days, the Chinese were utilizing the bicycles. So China was very famous for bicycle. Many of the countries used to say we should emulate China. But today even they are becoming richer and richer, and they are shedding up these bicycles. They are going for fuel vehicles. As a result of the pollution has also increased. Industrialization has also increased in China, because of which pollution has also increased. Okay. Now in Delhi it is the same case. In 1980s and 2000 itself, maximum number of cars was found in Delhi, capital of the entire country. Okay. Delhi, they found the vehicular emission was very, very high. The amount of lead in the atmosphere was high. The amount of carbon monoxide gases was high. The amount of particulate matter was high. There was a case study which was made. One of them files a public interest litigation. One of the good citizens of Delhi files a public interest litigation which the Supreme Court accepts. And in that case, Supreme Court says that from henceforth, all the public vehicles in the sense buses and other vehicles, they should all go for compressed natural gas, CNG. Okay, even though the distribution was a little tough, to an extent they were able to control the amount of carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide in the atmosphere because of the CNG. CNG burns more efficiently than, it burns completely, okay, more efficiently than petrol and diesel. That's the reason they suggest CNG. Very little remains unburned. CNG cannot be stolen or siphoned off. Okay, whereas petrol and diesel, they siphon off. You know about that. So that cannot be stolen. They cannot be adulterated with other gases. First of all, catching the gas and adulterating it is a tougher process. CNG cannot be adulterated with other gases like petrol or diesel are adulterated. That cannot happen in case of CNG. CNG is cheaper than petrol and diesel. Even today you might find many of the autos displaying LPG in Karnataka. So those autos are also going for CNG, compressed natural gas. So problem of use of CNG is the distribution centers at that point of time was lesser. But today we have lot of gas centers for the vehicles. Okay, LPG or CNG centers, a lot of them are there today. And as a result of it, most of our auto rickshaws, they are utilizing the LPG or the CNG as a fuel. Difficulty laying down pipelines of to deliver CNG, non-assurance of uninterrupted supply. These are the disadvantages or disadvantages of going for CNG. But today at present era, those disadvantages are not there because there are many centers which are distributing auto refill gas, they call it as, which is nothing but CNG. Okay, so you have to remember about that. So other parallel steps that they took in Delhi was more than 15 years old, any vehicle, if it is there, they have to undergo a fitness certificate. Okay, if they do not exhibit that fitness certificate, such vehicles are discarded. So phasing out of old vehicles. Then second one is use of unleaded petrol, which is happening at present also. Then use of low sulfur petrol and diesel. They want to reduce it to 50 ppm parts per million of petrol. They want to utilize less amount of sulfur. Application of strict pollution level norms for vehicles. At present you have BS4 stage vehicles, Bharat stage 4 vehicles. Okay, it is almost copied from the Euro norms, wherein the toxic gases liberated are all going to be very less. Euro 4 standards, the Bharat stage 4, BS4 vehicles are accepted. Today there are no BS3, BS2 vehicles. They are all phased out. At present, new vehicles, whatever you purchase, they are all BS4 stage vehicles, whether it's a car, motorcycles, I think it is BS3 vehicles. Okay. Now, auto fuel policy to cut down vehicular pollution. Steadily reducing sulfur and aromatic content in petrol and diesel fuels. So, Euro 2 norms, this is very old. Okay. Where they had 350 parts per million in diesel. How much was sulfur in case of petrol? 150 parts per million. In diesel it was 350 parts per million, ppm. Aromatic hydrocarbon to be reduced to 42%. Upgradation of vehicle engines. This was what happened during 2000. So in 2005, we have changed to BS4, which is equivalent to Euro 4 norms of vehicles. So noise pollution is also considered as a air pollution. Okay, so it is noise is any unwanted or undesirable sound, we call it as noise. Anything which exceeds 150-80 decibels to 150 decibels is the maximum that we can withstand. 150 decibels of sound, they are all noise. One man's music is another man's noise. For you it might be rock music, for us it is noise pollution. Okay, so it is the same. So noise pollution is based on decibels. Undesirable high level of sound is called as noise pollution. Especially the more the people are populated, the more the noise is there. The noise that you get from the vehicles which are moving, the people who are involved, shouting, activities, sports. These are all noise pollutions that we come across. Noise pollution is going to affect our psychological and physiological aspects of our body. Okay, so apart from not being attentive and losing our hearing capability also. Okay. So psychological and physiological disorders in human beings are a possibility of noise pollution. High sound level, 150 decibel, dB is decibel, unit is decibel. Okay. Or more may damage eardrums, tympanum. They get damaged, especially sonic jet passing through or taking off. If you are going to hear it directly, it is 150 decibels and more, it leads to damage of your eardrums. Okay. Noise causes sleeplessness, increase in heartbeat, etc. Increase heartbeat, altering breathing pattern. Try to be in a noise and try to study your examinations, syllabus. It becomes very, very tough. So you would like to have, especially during the examination, when you want to concentrate and focus, you expect least noise to take up, least distractions. Especially schools and hospital zones, the noise should be very less. They ask the vehicles not to honk or horn. Okay, so to avoid noise pollution. So this also you have to remember about noise pollution, which is a type of air pollution. Prevention of noise pollution. So soil, like there are many who take up silencer from their two-wheelers. You might have noticed that to create that noise, they want entire city to know that they are going out or coming in. Okay. So those sort of silencer removing from the vehicles, they are all hazardous things. They are all, what you call it as, against Motor Vehicular Act. They can confiscate the vehicles if they alter this silencers. Okay. Use of sound absorbent materials takes place in silencers so that they absorb the sound and very little is there. Nowadays vehicles that you get, they have very little sound. But if you go for 1980s and other vehicle, the Yamaha two-stroke engines and others, they create a lot of noise. Many like noise to be accompanied with them. Okay, so that's the reason they still now prefer those vehicles. But the noise should be quite less, for which they are utilizing absorbent materials so that they can absorb noise. Even in a theater, they have non-echoing materials, sound-absorbing materials are utilized in a theater or in an auditorium, so that there is no echoing of our voices. Okay, or the noise goes outside the classroom. Here we have glass panes which can reduce the noise by 40%. We have gone for special glass panes which reduces the noise by 40%. That's the reason whenever I'm taking a class, I ask you to shut the windows, because the noise level will be brought down. Okay? So permissible sound levels of crackers. Nowadays this Lirili Pataki, all those are removed now, isn't it? So the larger one, hydrogen bombs, they are all removing it out. Very soon even green eco-friendly crackers will be released from next year, because Supreme Court has present, it has given a ruling that existing crackers should abide by the green norms. Okay, from they might come out with certain eco-friendly crackers from next year. Okay, so demarcation of on-free zones around the schools and hospitals. Heartbeat increases, a heart patient is there and a person goes with huge noise of a vehicle, by that vibration itself will get another heart attack. Okay, so heartbeats are going to increase whenever noise is more, so that has to be reduced. At 10 o'clock or 12 o'clock when you are having a deep sleep, if you hear a loud noise, you get irritated, isn't it? Using loudspeakers after 8, bursting crackers after 8 itself is not permitted, isn't it? Or is it between 8 to 10? 8 to 10. After that, it is not allowed. Okay? So that also we should abide by. As lawful citizens, as citizens who know about the ill effects of noise, we should try to reduce noise. Utilization of loudspeakers. Okay? So that should be reduced. Animals are the most, you might have seen pet dogs and pet cats. Whenever it is Deepavali, they are the most scared animals, including birds. Why do we use crackers to scare the monkeys, who are not getting scared at present? They are getting habituated to crackers. Okay? So, but generally animals are scared of loud noises and bursting noise. Okay? So the next one that we are going to discuss after air pollution is water pollution and its control. Any undesirable change in the physical, chemical and biological characteristics of water, we call it as water pollution. The pollutant can be many of them. What are the water pollutants that you can visualize? See, domestic sewage released from the apartments or flats in and around the lakes. What else can you visualize? The water is used as a cooling agent in thermal plants, and that hot water is released again back into water, which changes the temperatures of water, and that destroys the aquatic life that is present in water. They get cooked because of water being released, hot water being released from thermal plants. Okay, so then what else can you visualize apart from domestic sewage? Industrial effluents, tanneries, like metallurgical industries, like leaching, they use lot of water. For one of the ways of removing the waste from ore is by washing them. So water is used for those purposes. So water, if it accumulates organic, inorganic nutrients, heavy metals from industries, it is a polluted water. And if you are going to have such water, it leads to lot of abnormalities. Okay? So you will have to go through this eutrophication, biomagnification. So those terms I'll be discussing one by one. See, in domestic sewage, 99% of domestic sewage consists of water, 99.9%. 0.1% of it contains the impurities, which can be fecal matter, it can be the nitrates, sulfates, which might have come from the shampoos or from the soaps that we use, detergents. So those are all dissolved in these waters. That itself, 0.1 impurities itself makes that water unfit for consumption. So water is not potable. Potable means drinkable. Okay, so remember about that. So sewage contains dissolved salts like nitrates, phosphates and other nutrients, apart from toxic metal ions and organic compounds. It can be mercury, cadmium. So they are all the some of the toxic metals that can be found there. The amount of organic matter in water is estimated by BOD. What is BOD? They have asked for one mark. Biological oxygen demand. The amount of oxygen required for oxidizing all the organic matter present in 1 liter, we call it as BOD. Biological oxygen demand increases whenever DO is decreasing, dissolved oxygen. Water has certain amount of oxygen dissolved in it from atmosphere, which we call it as diffused oxygen or dissolved oxygen. Whenever dissolved oxygen is going to get reduced, biological oxygen demand from the fishes and the plants, they are going to increase. You have to understand about that. So what is biochemical oxygen demand? The amount of oxygen required for oxidizing all the organic matter present in 1 liter of water, we call it as biochemical oxygen demand. So changes that takes place due to discharge of sewage into the river. Even in Bangalore, we have this Rishabhavati River, which is converted into a sewage plant. Earlier, Rishabhavati River was having pristine water. Then what they did was all the sewage in and around Bangalore, they all let the sewage into this Rishabhavati River Valley. Today it is utilized as a treatment plant, sewage treatment plant at Kengeri. If you get down at the bus stop opposite to that, you have the Kengeri plant where they are having this water treatment plant. Today our sewage from all the homes, they are all entering into Rishabhavati River Valley, where they are being treated for the domestic sewage. Okay, so now some of the fecal matter, other things, they can be broken down by the biodegradation of microorganisms. They don't require any special elements to be done. The physical particulates like bottles, air, cloth, fibers, they can all be separated out from water. Okay, so now there are certain things which we cannot remove them, heavy metals. So the microorganisms that might be present, like E. coli and other microorganisms which might cause serious diseases, they have to be treated. Generally, the treated water has chlorinated. They use chlorinated water, chlorinating the water so that the organisms are all, microorganisms are all killed, so that they are free from disease-causing microorganisms. Whatever water we get from our tap, they are all chlorinated water, so they change my